Tonight, Suicide Prevention Weekend. So we thank you for being here today. We look forward to a good day of learning and a fellowship with one another and our community members. So we're just so glad that you're here, and I just want to talk to you guys about a couple of things this morning. If you guys will just open your brochures, if you have them with you, we'll just kind of go through them just quickly. I'll give you a minute to pull them out. I hear the rustling around. If you look at the schedule of events there, you'll just kind of see how the day is laid out for you. And I'll just kind of notice, tell you that lunch is at 1, and you can kind of see that there's the breaks built in, and you'll also see where the breakout sessions are as well. If you look to your right, where it talks about the workshop overview and the breakout sessions, you can look and kind of see what you might like to go to. If you go to a session and there's 20, 25 people in there, you might just go to a different session, but I assure you that everyone will be able to go to each session if you would like. But also, if you are only here for a short while and you would like to attend a particular session, we'll make an allotment for that, and you can go to that session. But also, if you're here and you don't have a preference, I would highly suggest that you go to Isabelle's, because she's flown here from Washington, D.C., and she has a lot of room to host a lot of people in her session. So we hope that you'll go see her for sure. If you have questions for our panel, which we'll definitely have a panel discussion tomorrow, there will be baskets in the back and a basket up front right here. You'll see this little white one. There's one in the back as well. You can write your question anonymously. We know that some people might have questions, things just hidden deep down in their hearts, maybe they want to ask, but they don't want to ask it out loud. If you'll just write your question on that, and we'll get to those questions. For those people who are joining us online on Facebook, or maybe I'll register, if you have questions and you'd like to submit them in the comments, please do that. We will try to answer those questions as well. So we want to be as inclusive as we possibly can. Also, at the end of the day, there is a survey that we will have that will be handed out. And that survey will just kind of ask you how you felt today went. Are there things that you think that we can do different? We want to make sure this is a polished event and that it reaches people and the questions that they have the best that we can. I'll also say that we'll also have those baskets for questions in each of the breakout sessions, so I forgot to mention that. I'd also say that if you'd like to connect with us on Facebook or Instagram, you can do that on 13 Reasons to Fly SEK. And if you're taking any photos today or spreading something maybe that you learned today, if you'll use that hashtag 13 Reasons to Fly SEK, or hashtag not one more, SEK, not one more person, SEK, please use that as well. If you are familiar with Snapchat and you would like to use a geo filter today, we have one too for this event that you can use for any pictures that you might take that you might want to share with friends. We're also trying to be as hospitable as we can. If you would like a drink, a bottle of water, if you'd like some snacks as you go about, there is a full table of snacks for your convenience. Feel free to grab a snack and take it with you. It's all down in the basement. And please notice the signage about the building, about what the workshops are. I believe that is all of my housekeeping items that I've been given. I have my chicken scratch here. With no other questions or things that someone's telling me I need to say, I'm going to pass this over to Charlotte Miller to introduce our keynote speaker. Kansas, Colony, Garnett, Kincaid, Westphalia,
Ella Miller. I lost my son Matthew in June to suicide. I wrote a letter to God and had it read at his funeral, and I asked, why did you choose to sacrifice my only son? And show me what you want me to learn from this tragedy. I'm ready. Well, here I am 5 months later, and I'm standing in front of all of you, trying to help there to not be one more. I don't want to be here today. Where I want to be is at the K-State West Virginia game with my son. He was supposed to be a sophomore this year at K-State. And that's never going to be a reality. So what I really want to do today is just stick my head in the sand, go back to bed, and pull the sheets over. But that's not going to help anybody. And I want to, that's not going to bring Matt back, and it's not going to help save one more. So I'm here today, and I was very honored to be asked to be on this committee, and I want it to be something that's every year. I want this to continue and help others. I know firsthand the despair that Matthew probably felt that day. I fought depression all my life, and had an uncle that attempted suicide and failed, and lived the next 20 years in a wheelchair. He was paralyzed. So I always preach to my children that it's a permanent solution to a temporary problem. That's how my parents explained it to me. And I told them, and then I was very upset when this happened to Matthew, and I was like, I preached that, I looked for that, I did all those things, why? And you know, Matt was one when he died, so I really never knew him. And it was always just a story or just a memory. So there's no clues to a lot of things outside looking in. I had everything, my son had everything, but inside it's totally different. I had family, homecoming queen, all live, all state, everything, but inside I felt I wasn't good enough. I didn't know if I could be smart enough to go to college. You just have all those negativities that just fill your brain. I'll never forget, I had a friend that I knew through sports that committed suicide at college. She was from Chanute, and that's when I went to the doctor and I got help. And I found out that I have a chemical imbalance, that I don't produce enough of the chemical that makes you feel good, makes you feel happy. And no matter what I did, how good a shape I was in, ate the right food, no matter what, my body still is not going to produce that. And so once I found that, and they said that you were doing the right thing, I just had a weight lifted off of me. Didn't mean that it solved it, but it made it manageable. Some days are more manageable than others. Don't get me wrong, I still struggle too. I struggle every day. But my wish this weekend is for everyone to find at least one thing to take away from this workshop and help either them or someone they love. I hope everyone can get one more tool to put in their tool belt of life and make the world a little better and a little brighter. We have an amazing group of knowledgeable people with us, and they've spent hours, and I appreciate it so much. They're bringing all these tools to you guys, and hopefully you can find something that you can take away this weekend. And I cannot think of a more talented, brave, compassionate individual to help lead us this weekend and help all of us find that missing tool to put in our tool belt of life than Isabelle Cole. Belle is a wise beyond her years. At just 19 years old last month, this amazing girl has founded a nonprofit organization called 13 Reasons to Fly to combat the stigma and glorification surrounding mental illness. She has flown all the way from Washington, D.C. to share with us her mission, which is to bring awareness to mental health and also show people that the hope she has found. She is a strong believer that you are more than what you're going through, and it's okay not to be okay. Please help me give a big welcome to Isabelle Cole.
The way you talk about your young people, the way you show up and walks into a coffee shop and knows everybody. break short enough today to rally for a cause. I know we are a community full of love and light. Unfortunately, that doesn't immune you to any of the times of darkness or despair. I believe that suicide prevention, mental health awareness are the most unaddressed, multi-generational, cross-cultural, social justice issues of our times. Yet, we don't talk about it. That stops today. I want to take a moment to acknowledge that some of these issues will be difficult to talk about, and they may stir up some unwanted emotions and thoughts. That being said, you're in the right place. We have incredible mental health counselors on site, and so I want to point you to Jalen or Lisa, so that if you have any questions or you need some help throughout the day, feel free to reach out to them or any adult that is on the committee. All right. So to get started, I want to pull out my life savings. Don't laugh. All right. What is this? I don't know. Can you tell me what this is? A dollar bill. All right. So, if I go to the store and I see a pack of Skittles for 90 cents, can I buy it with this dollar bill? Can I buy it with this dollar bill?
Yes.
Okay. So if I ball the dollar bill up, think about it. If I ball this dollar bill up, it can't be worth a dollar now, right? How much is it worth?
A dollar.
What if I ball it up, step on it, what if I stomp on it? Pick it up, how much is it worth now?
A dollar.
So what if I ball this dollar bill up, stomp on it, and throw it in the trash?
Dollar.
How much is this dollar bill worth now? Nothing. It's still worth a dollar. You're telling me that I just bought this dollar bill up, stepped on it, threw it in the trash, tore it in half, and it's still worth a dollar. Then why, if this dollar bill, if this glorified green, very important piece of paper, does lose its worth or its value, why do you think that you have lost your worth or your value? Many of you feel like you've been stepped on, disregarded, constricted, you feel like you've been abandoned, talked about, abused, or even torn in half. Someone hurt you, or your brain has tricked you into thinking you're worthless. This dollar bill has value because some very important men put value on it many years ago. They said no matter what happens to it, it can still be wiped off, taped back together, and it will still be worth a dollar. Its worth doesn't change simply because it changed shape. I'm here to tell you that you were born with value, and the Creator looked at you and said, you are good, you have purpose, and there is nothing in this world that can ever take your worth or your value away. An old Japanese proverb said that once glass is broken in a household, once china is shattered, once a bowl is broken, it is not broken. They fill it together with gold. They fill the cracks with gold. Our cracks are what makes us human, not broken. This is an art form. They believe that when something suffered damage, when something has a history and tells a story, it becomes even more beautiful. Now, let's get one thing straight. I am not telling you you're broken. Hardships are what makes us human. You have a story, so tell it. Don't hide it. Shout it from the mountaintop. Mark your cracks with gold, because your uniqueness, your quirks, your struggles are what makes you strong. Your cracks are what makes you beautiful. Okay, moving on from analogies, I'm going to tell you all about my cracks, because just like ancient bowls, I have history, and I have a story to tell. So a few years back, my older sister, my best friend, my role model, Charlotte, was diagnosed with cancer. Thankfully, her cancer was treatable, and after a year of chemotherapy, radiation, and surgeries, she beat it. My 16-year-old sister, soccer player, track runner, writer, was now a cancer survivor. What I didn't fully understand was that in those countless nights she spent in her hospital room, she didn't just lose weight, hair, and health. She lost confidence. And what crept into her head instead was a persistent voice whispering, you are not enough. The more convincing the voice became, the less I saw my sister. I craved those moments where I could still reach her. The highlight of each of my day as a 13-year-old girl was running home from school, sitting by her side, and getting anything I could do to make her feel better. I'm a little bit of a fixer. Maybe, just maybe, I can make her well again. But on May 12, 2014, I came bouncing home from school like I always did, put on a brave face, and went to my Except this day was different. This time I couldn't bring her a sock or water to make her feel better. Instead, I ran back down the hallway with my trembling fingers to outline the wall. Thankfully, this wasn't the end of her story. It wasn't the end of mine. My beautiful, witty, kind sister was in the hospital and didn't want to see me. Tried to take her own life. There's no way. The truth was, Charlotte had been battling intense depression, anorexia, and anxiety for months. The depths of which were clouded by her cancer recovery. For the years to come, she was placed in a variety of psychiatric hospitals, looking for the right formula to help her conquer her eating disorder. At the same time, my mom's longtime boyfriend moved out, my nan passed away, my brother began acting out, and I was left, well, virtually growing up on my own. So, I began taking care of my schoolwork, my family's struggles, my soccer schedule, volunteer opportunities, and of course, visited the hospital as much as I possibly could. After Charlotte's diagnosis, my family's world flipped upside down, and I felt I was the one that had to hold it all up. For years, I teetered between extracurriculars and devoted myself to being perfect. I told myself that my role as a teenager was to be the child that my parents wouldn't have to worry about, and they didn't. But as the years passed and I entered high school, perfect changed. Now, I had to be pretty, I had to be thin, I had to be popular, and I had to be happy. I became a pretty good actor. I got all A's in school, started on 3 varsity sports, was popular, had a boyfriend, but what no one knew was that every single day I would go home exhausted. Physically, emotionally, mentally exhausted. Nothing was left. The only thing that was there was that smiling face I put out to everybody else. What was inside? I felt empty. I couldn't show that I wasn't perfect until I did. Those things that kept me going, the sports, the family, and the friends that I loved so much, they got pushed out by the sadness that crept in. They enveloped my once joyous life. So 3 years ago, December 9th, 2016, I had enough. I was tired of waking up each day, putting on a smile, just to return home, exhausted and depressed. My mom, sister, and brother had already been through so much, so I was just another burden. That evening, I decided I'd read them about that burden. That Friday, I'll always remember, yes, because of its darkness, but moreover, because it began my journey of recovery. What I didn't know is that I would spend the next 9 months of my young life, the next year of my not-so-perfect teenage life in hospitals. To be completely honest, it sucked. The first few months, my symptoms worsened. I blamed myself for not finishing the job, for putting my family through this. I blamed myself for how I was feeling, and self-blamed that I didn't need help. Don't worry about me. Why was I so insistent on being okay when I clearly wasn't? Because we live in a society that cultivates comparison. We live in a society that preaches perfection. I tried to end my life, but told my psychiatrist that I was okay and that I didn't need help. Because it was so ingrained in me that I had to be okay. I'm a young woman in society, so I must be happy. This is the narrative that we need to change. What I tried to tell myself in the midst of all this pain was that I must be preparing for something bigger. There's no way that all of this is for nothing. I know there's a God out there, and I know that everything happens for a reason, so he must be developing me, not punishing me. A glimmer of hope emerged in the kingdom of God, because he promised that he had a plan. So 6 months into insisting, 6 months into treatment, I hit my rock bottom. My friends had just finished their sophomore year of high school, and here I was, the perfect, popular girl sitting in the corner of a strict hospital room, trapped in by my own chains. That was my wake-up call. This is my life. I know it hasn't been easy, but what am I going to do to sit here in the corner, suffering, when everyone is out there living? Don't I deserve to live? So, I decided that that I need to make some change, because I'm not going to sit here anymore and feel sorry for myself in my life. So, what if I tried more? I decided it was time to break free, so I took a pen and a paper and started writing. The next day, in the wake of the Netflix show, 13 Reasons Why, a show based on 13 Reasons Why a young girl, just like me, committed suicide. I was furious. The very thing I was going through, the illness that was threatening my loved ones and the peers of the hospital, was being glorified on the screen. I've always been a fixer, and I couldn't just sit with this anger, so I used it as a catalyst for change. What if we focused on 13 reasons to fly? What if we focused on reasons to live and hold on to hope? There will always be things threatening to pull us down, but there are also always going to be dreams, joys, and hope. So that's what I began focusing on. I wanted to stand up for all my peers that found themselves voiceless and too scared to speak up. It became my mission, my purpose, to share the hope that I had found, the hope that took me months to realize was there all along. It doesn't just magically appear. As I actually began working towards recovery, I started spreading the campaign throughout the hospital and challenged my peers to come up with their own reasons to fly. What helps you through those dark times? What keeps you going? The response was overwhelming, and as my confidence increased, so did theirs. 13 Reasons to Fly became something to live for. My life wasn't so dark anymore. 2 months later, I discharged from the hospital and signed the papers to transform 13 Reasons to Fly into a nonprofit organization. This little idea that a suicidal, bulimic 16-year-old had turned into a nonprofit because of hope. Now don't be fooled. I didn't wake up one day and suddenly want to live. My psychiatrist didn't give me a magic pill. Those 9 dark months were incredibly challenging, but I got through. And I grew through it because I had faith, I had family, and I had hope. You might not have an easy road, but you have faith. That your pain has a purpose, for it's my pain that brought me here today. And that's a beautiful thing. I shared this with Charlotte yesterday, as I used to think that it was joy and similarity that made great friends. But in reality, it's pain that unites us. It's pain that we're all here today. It's pain that gives us something to work towards. Family. This town, this is family. I went there last night with a group of 15 amazing young people because this town is like a family. Whether you're close to the blood-related part of your family or not, you have people that love and care about you. And hope will bring you through the darkest of times. So what do we have to do? To get there, we have to push our loved ones to get help, push ourselves to get help, to keep going, because you are worth it, and it's time that someone told you that, it's time that you tell yourself that. So a couple things. You're never alone. My mom visited me every single day in the hospital without fail. She would drive 2 hours, visit my sister in the hospital, drive another hour after work to visit me. Sometimes she was taking 5 minutes after I asked her to leave, it was too much, and others I would beg for her to stay, to take me home. But she showed up, day after day, because she's scared, because she cared. There is always someone that cares about you, whether you realize it or not. I didn't realize it in the moment, but looking back, she is my rock. 2, you are loved. Your mindset matters. When I didn't want help, I didn't want treatment, and I wasn't open to change, it didn't change. It didn't get better. I was in a hospital full of people that wanted to help me, but until I opened up, nothing changed. Once I realized that I needed help and that my life wouldn't improve on its own, that's when changes started happening within me. Okay, so I'll tell you a little bit about my organization now and what we do. So it's been 3 years since I started. Two years. And after I signed those papers, we immediately started spreading our message around Massachusetts, which is where I'm from. And the goal is to save up the stigma that surrounds mental illness. So that's why I'm here, and that's why I share my story. I hear someone says, me too. Someone says, my sister went through that too. And that makes it worth it every single time. So my goal is to go into different hospitals, schools, and places of worship to share my story so that people know they're not alone. Okay, I need you guys to be vulnerable with me for a second. All right, this is not my script, but I'm just gonna go with it. Raise your hand if you or someone you know has been affected by mental illness. Keep your hands up. Look around. All right, you can put your hands down. So why, if every single person knows someone or is someone, then why aren't we talking about it? Why do we feel so ashamed? That's why I'm here. That's why I'm sharing my story, because every time I do, I find these courageous, brave people coming up to me and telling me that they have a voice, but they haven't been sharing that voice. You are given a power. You are given a gift. You are given your voice, your hope, and your faith. And you need to start sharing that. I'm getting that myself. Okay. So, now I'm here because I met Matt and Colin 5 months ago at a conference in Kansas City. And they talked to me about the struggles that was going on here. And now here I am, 4 months later. So I want you to remember, it's the cracks that allow the light to shine through. So I'll leave you with one question. How will you be the light? Thank you.
Really quick.